Hey everyone, I'm Shaz Jones and I'm your host of Bible Hacks. And I'm excited to tell you that I have a guest with me today. And that guest is Paul Clayton Gibbs, the founder of PAIS Movement and an author and speaker. Welcome to the podcast, Paul.
Thank you. It's a privilege to be here. Thanks for the invitation.
Oh, you're welcome. I'm delighted that you're here. Now, I want to take you back 31 years to 1992. What does Sharon mean to you?
Well, Sharon was, we used to pronounce it Sharon, but Sharon was the name of the church that I was part of. So it was the church that I was kind of connected to when I first became a Christian and grew up in and learned a lot of ministry in. And yeah, I was there for, I don't know, a long, long time. That's where I met my wife, and our boys first went to church there. And it was the church that kind of launched the PAIS Movement, which is the missionary organization I lead.
Right. So what does PAIS mean?
So PAIS is a New Testament Greek word for a child who serves the king. And after some time working in schools, kind of representing that church and other churches, I was at a minister's meeting, and a lot of the ministers were talking about what Paul's doing in schools. And I thought, well, no, this is about all of us. So I went back to my pastor and said, hey, I need a name really for what we do, maybe something project, because it'll probably only last a couple of years. And he said, well, there's no word in the Bible for teenager, because that was invented in the 50s. And then he just found this word that was a child who serves the king, which seemed appropriate. So we pronounce it PAIS. It might be pronounced a different way, but that's how we pronounce it. So,
okay. Are you aware of the Spanish word PAIS?
Yeah. Yeah. So I think that means nation, I think, if I'm correct.
Yeah. So, it means nation, country, land, realm, because Spain is a kingdom. So it also means kingdom. And it's one of their national newspapers as well. So when I first heard it, I was like, oh, that's interesting that it's the Spanish word for kingdom.
Well, it's kind of cool, isn't it? All kind of works. God knows what he's doing. For me, I thought it was just a random word that seemed to fit. I was a bit desperate in the moment, but it actually worked out really, really well. So,
yeah. Now, I met you about 5 weeks ago in Wollongong, and when you were speaking, you mentioned briefly about kingdom filters, and that really piqued my interest. And I was like, I want to have another conversation with you. What can you tell me about filters?
Yeah, I don't know if we should go back a little bit further, but let me start off with that. So I think that Jesus had filters. He was sifting the people who were following him. And the three that I kind of think through are parables, healing, and the filter he gave his disciples when they were to go on mission. So parables, I think the NIV Study Bible talks about the fact that, I can't quote this exactly because I've not got it to hand, but it basically says parables are there so to stop lazy people finding the truth, which is a really harsh language, but it's basically, its description goes on. This is not in the actual Bible section. It's in the notes. The NIV Study Notes talks about Jesus is looking for us to lean forward. So as we lean forward, he reveals things to us. But if we're there just waiting for it to come to us, it's probably not going to happen in the same way. And the first kind of filter of that type I saw in Jesus' ministry was when he was performing miracles, because I was looking at the miracles that Jesus performed once, and there was a list of them in one passage. And when you see them all together, you notice things. And I noticed that, oh, Jesus never initiated all of these. It was somebody else initiated it and he responded. And I thought, that's interesting. So I spent the whole evening, the whole night looking through every time Jesus healed someone and every cross-reference. And I realized there were only five that you could possibly say Jesus initiated, but even then he didn't really. You know, one of them was the man at the pool of Bethsaida, and him just being there because there was the belief that, you know, the angel would come and touch the water and the first person in would get healed. Even just being there was a request. And three of the times that it looks like Jesus initiated healing were because somebody asked him about the Sabbath, and he used healing as an object lesson. The only time you could really say that Jesus initiated healing was the widow's son who was dead. And so he heals. As far as we know, there's nothing else going on. He just heals or brings that person to life. So, but generally speaking, there's a filter. He's looking for us to lean forward. And then when he sends his disciples out, the third one I mentioned, he basically asks them to do what he does. So in Luke 10, he talks about going into the villages. I use the words spread, spot, stay, send. So spread, tell everybody. Don't decide in advance who's going to respond. Tell everybody. But then he gives them this form of spotting the people of peace, which in that particular case he uses is hospitality. So those who open their homes to you, go and stay with them and heal the sick within the household. So even then there's a kind of filter that Jesus is looking for. I think there's a reason for that. So I think there are various filters that Jesus uses. You called them kingdom filters. But the various filters that Jesus uses to sift us, you could say.
Why is that important, do you think? Why is he trying to divide people up into, you know, one group that passed the filter and one group that doesn't?
I think there's probably a number of reasons. I'm not sure his purpose is trying to divide people up. I think it's like, you know, we often say Jesus doesn't test us, so he finds us. He discovers things about us. He tests us, so we discover things about ourselves. So I'm not sure he's trying to divide us. I think he's trying to reveal things to us. That's the way I see it, at least, you know. So one of the reasons I wrote a book about in one of my books when it comes to outreach is with this idea of spread, spot, stay, send. You spread, don't decide in advance who's going to respond. Reach as many people as you can. But then you give people an opportunity to lean forward. That's how you spot the people of peace. And one of the things I mentioned there is I think that creates ownership within us and the kind of self-awareness in us that, yeah, we need God. We're kind of admitting, humbling ourselves, yes, we need him. So it kind of brings us to a place where we're acknowledging that ourselves. There's a story. It's not, you know, I've never wrote about this, but it just comes to mind. I think it was a Billy Graham conference where a man, quite a wealthy, well-to-do man, was in the upper seats, and Billy Graham gave his appeal, and the guy decided that he wanted to respond, but he didn't want to go out to the front with everybody else. You know, why should he? He was a kind of like well-to-do guy. He didn't want to be with the masses. So he just waves to the usher and says, I want to say that prayer. I want to do what Mr. Graham has told us to do. And the steward says to him, well, you need to go to the front. And he says, no, I just need to be saved here on my seat. And interestingly, the steward says, no, you can't. You can't be saved there on your seat, which most of us would have a theological problem with. Anyway, the story goes, apparently the next night, the man's sitting in the same place and hears the same message, basically, and says to the usher, okay, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go forward. And the usher says to him, there's no need. I can lead you to Jesus where you are right now.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't need to explain the point of that, I don't think. So it's bringing us to that place where we're fully, truly submitted. So if you don't mind me just continuing with this, you said kingdom filter. And I think that's the key issue, is that, in my opinion, my belief is there've always been and always has been, and certainly is right now, two types of Christianity. I think they predate Catholicism and they predate being a Protestant or Calvinism or Arminianism. I think actually even predate Christianity. So you could say there were two forms of Judaism. And Jesus talks about this in the Sermon on the Mount when he says, don't be like the pagans. And because he talks about things like, you know, like, don't worry about what you're wearing, what you eat. I think we misunderstand what he's saying. And we think, oh, what Jesus is saying here is, don't worry after all these worldly possessions, seek God instead. But the people who were following him already knew that. What he was really saying was, don't worship God the way that the pagans worship their gods. And basically the pagans would sacrifice and worship for the purpose of what they would get from their God and what God would give them and the way God would bless them. And so the way I frame these two types of Christianity is, the first one I call it Christian-centric. So we pursue God. So we pursue our vision. We do it God's way. So God gives us what we want. And then there's kingdom centric, which I think is what Jesus was alluding to, which is we pursue his kingdom. We do it God's way. So we give him what he wants. And I think, you know, when you look at it, Jesus isn't spends virtually no time speaking to non-believers. All his time is speaking to believers, people who believe in God. Most of the people he's attracting are people who want God. There's a filter there. They're coming to him. They're coming to him on the mountaintop or wherever it might be. And I think what he's trying to do is bring them to that place of a different kind of fellowship. And these filters are helping people realize, he's not trying to divide into two groups. He's just helping people realize, okay, I thought I was pursuing God, but actually what I'm doing is I'm pursuing everything else the world is pursuing. It's just I'm trying to use God to get me there. Or I'm realizing it's God who's going to give me that. And Jesus is saying, no, what I want you to do is not simply believe in me or trust in me or love me, but believe in what I believe and trust in what I trust in and love what I love, which is the world, and in the sense of leading people to him. Hope that's not too wordy. Hope that makes sense.
Yeah, it makes sense. I was just wondering if you've got like a definition of the kingdom of God or a way of helping people understand what that concept is.
Yes, that's a great question, because if I go to a church and say, hands up, who knows what the church is, most hands go up, and they'll say to me, it's not the building, it's the people, which of course they're correct. When I say to people, what's the kingdom of God? People look a little bit more sheepish and not sure. So the Greek word used in Matthew is, if I'm pronouncing it correctly, the New Testament Greek word is basileia, and it means the rule or the realm or the reign or the royalty of God. So essentially where God rules, where God is Lord, is the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God. Those two words are interchangeable, those two phrases. So that's how the kingdom of God is here, but the kingdom of God is still near. The kingdom of God is here, but the kingdom of God is yet to come, because it's not a geographical place. It's a state of being, really. And that's why the kingdom of God is growing in me as different parts of my thinking, my language, my actions come under his lordship. The kingdom of God is growing in me. And that's how the kingdom of God can grow through me, because as I reach more people for him and lead more people to him, the kingdom of God expands that way. So it's about the lordship, the rule, the royalty of people. And again, it comes back down to the filter. It's people coming to that place where they're realizing, I need to be truly humbled and truly submitted to God's will, where I'm seeking his will. I'm not seeking my will, using God to get it.
So have you got a specific example of, say, an entrepreneur in running their business? What would the kingdom of God look like for them?
Yeah. So there are lots of ways. So we work with various businesses or business people, at least. And one of my best mates is runs a software company. So this is just a small example. So I would say he and his wife are very kingdom centric, I would say. And during, you know, the Black Lives Matter whole thing came up, and I think he, you know, like a lot of people, had mixed response to that as a movement and the organization Black Lives Matters. But the idea of, you know, helping people who from all races, particularly if people are maybe not had the same opportunity, really hit home to him. And so what he did was he decided, what I'm going to do is I'm going to move church, which I thought was astounding. So he went to a church he really liked. He thought, I'm going to go to a church that is mainly a Black, African-American church, because he knew that he often hired people. And most of the people he hired were people he knew, friends, related, came out of a relationship. And so he thought, well, if I know I've hired a lot of people from the church I was at, so if I move to a new church, naturally I'm going to end up hiring a lot more African-Americans. And I know that may not sound a direct answer, but for me, that was an idea of, I want to expand the kingdom of God, because, sorry, what the missing piece is, in his business, they get the opportunity to share the faith and they get connected with other Christians. So he's thinking, the more people I can get into that mix, I can connect to more people. So what he does is he moves away from something that he would probably prefer to be at, a church that he really liked, in order to seek first the kingdom of God, in order to expand the kingdom of God, if that makes sense.
So is it about our thoughts or our imagination, or is it about application or infrastructure, or how does the kingdom of God, how do we apply the kingdom of God to our business? What's the best way that we can demonstrate the kingdom?
I think that's a great question. I don't know if I know all the answers to that. It's going to depend on the business and the setup and the infrastructure. I mean, the answer to all those questions is yes, it's about all those things. but I have what I call the kingdom question, which has guided me through my life. And it's been, what can I do to most effectively advance the kingdom of God? So out of all the options I have, which one will most effectively advance the kingdom of God? Now, I think every entrepreneur, every business leader has to ask that themselves about their business. But I think it is, a lot of it's to do with intentionality. Again, I don't want to make it too teacherish, but there's a word we don't use in Christian churches, but I think is completely the center of everything Jesus ever taught, which is this concept of kavanah, which is a Jewish term. And kavanah means to have an awareness of God's presence and purpose in what you do. So the argument is, do mitzvot require kavanah or don't mitzvot require kavanah? Which basically means when you perform a commandment, have you really performed it if you've not done it for God's purpose, if you've done it for your purpose instead? And there's a whole background to that, which I won't go into unless you're interested. And so I think as far as that answers your question, it's having that awareness of God's presence, because God's presence leads to us to a better understanding of God's purpose, right? So it's weighing up which of these things will most advance the kingdom of God. And again, that's going to come down to people's businesses. So the business I just spoke about, I know they used to do a lunchtime pop-up kitchen for free so people could go and get free food. And there were opportunities there to talk about Jesus, but it wasn't too overt. They once a week have a lunchtime Haverim Bible study, which is something we created, a methodology we created. So there's some intentionality there about, well, how do I intentionally connect people without abusing my position? How do I intentionally connect people to the Bible? So a lot of it's about intentionality. It's about thinking through what you do and being intentional about it for the purpose of God.
Okay. And you mentioned there the Bible. Obviously, BibleHax podcast is interested in how we practically apply the Bible. And the way that you train PAIS apprentices to have Bible studies is quite different, I think, to most other discipleship methodologies. So can you talk a bit about how you train them?
Yeah. So we work primarily with young adults who we train to be mentors to young people. So we have a lot of millennials, the next generation's coming up, post-Christian, post-modern. So many years ago, I was doing a study on that, and it was interesting. And what popped up from that were, I think Leonard Sweet said it best, use this idea of epic. That generation needs to experience, not simply be educated. They need to participate, not simply to be presented to. Some of this is my language. They need images that ask them questions, not simply give them answers. And they need to be connected to their peer groups to discover truth collaboratively, in a collaborative way. So I'm reading all that. That's interesting. Okay. And then independent in my mind, I was also getting into trying to understand what Jesus meant by what he said, because I wasn't always sure that everything Jesus taught was exactly what was seen in church and vice versa. And so I went down, I did a lot of research into context, and I started learning a lot about the rabbinic way of teaching. And a couple of things happened. One was I realized, oh, wow, this is the answer to this. Like, this totally fits into, just fits really, really well to this. And along that way, I started to notice, I think it was in the NIV study Bible again, actually, I noticed this word padis. And padis is a Persian word. So in the Middle Ages, the rabbis looked back at the second temple period when Jesus was operating, and highlighted certain ways that they would study the Bible. Okay, so And hadith is a word made up of four different words. I don't know how much information you need about this, but Peshat, Remez, Drash, and Sud. And they were four ways of looking at the Bible. If I was to really simplify it, the basic difference between what you've probably seen and what we do is rather than the Bible teacher being someone who pushes information onto someone, they're the person that people can pull information from. So the way Haverim is the word we give it, Haverim means friends who study together, is we look at a passage of scripture in those four different ways. So first of all, we ask the question, we look at what's called the Peshat, the context, what is the simple meaning, and do we understand enough of the context to know what the simple meaning is? Then we ask, is there any remez here? Remez was a way of saying something without saying something. So people often think about Jesus being a brilliant at parables, which of course he was, but I think he just blew everybody out of the water with the way he invoked remez. But we don't know what it is, so we don't see it in the Bible, but it's everywhere, particularly in the New Testament, is Jesus invoked remez. And it's a way of saying things without saying them. So you go somewhere and that's a hint. Remez means hint. Or you say something, but you don't say the rest of it, because you're hinting at the rest of it. It's one of the reasons Jesus annoyed the Pharisees so much, because he would say things and he would attack them without actually saying it. He was a real politician, really, Jesus. So that's a way that we discover. Most of that's about, a lot of remez is about revealing who Christ is. And then there's drash, which is where you actively put yourself in the situation of either you put yourself in God's place or someone representing God, or you put somebody in someone else's place who's engaging with God. And there's a certain mechanism you use to create what's called midrash. So it sounds more complicated than it is, right? And then the final stage is sued, where it's about revelation. You just wait on God and you're asking God, is there anything I'm missing? And what does your Holy Spirit need to say to me? So if I was to summarize all that, what happens is you put people in a group and the leader doesn't say, okay, here's a passage of scripture, here's what you need to know about this passage of scripture. What the leader does is ask questions and then give them the places to go and find the answers. And then people pull their answers, and what that leader then does is fill in any gaps, so anything they've not discovered yet. So it creates a lot of ownership, and it goes back to this filter. If you just want easy answers, it's not the place for you. Yeah. If you just want, well, I just need to know what to do about this, or I just need to know what to believe about this, I'm actually not sure that's what Jesus wants. We kind of think that's more spiritual, but I think it's less spiritual. God wants us to wrestle with the Bible, because it teaches us so much about ourselves if we wrestle with it in that way. So it's a very simple and not elaborate way of explaining it, but it's four levels. I write about it in the book, Haverim, How to Study Anything with Anyone. And it's a brilliant methodology. We use it with teenagers, and teenagers can do it. And the final thing I say about it is what it's really doing is not simply teaching people about the Bible, it's teaching people how to study any scripture. So if you go through that process, those four steps, with a passage of scripture four or five times, I would suggest you can then study anything in the Bible, any topic, any subject, any epistle, any passage. So it's teaching people how to study, not simply what to study.
That's good. And am I right in assuming that your PAIS apprentices don't just teach scripture, or don't just mentor about the Bible, but they also do like vocational skills or like real world skills? Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, they do both. I mean, we're an international organization, so obviously our what we're allowed to do, we have a school charter. And that's online, where we say, look, this is, we make certain promises, and one of them is we won't go outside of the law, or we won't exploit an opportunity, but we will try and create opportunities that lead a conversation towards God and allow us to say those things. But in a lot of schools, at least initially, we're not allowed to say anything like that unless a student asks the question. And so, yes, we teach a lot of vocational skills, more mentorship than discipleship.
Okay. And this is, you mentioned you're in a lot of nations. How many nations is PAIS movement in?
I think it's 20.
Wow. Okay, awesome. And what's the main way that people become an apprentice in PAIS?
So we have staff positions as well, and people can get involved in lots of different ways. But when it comes down to being an apprentice, maybe I'll just explain what that means, is we offer a free mission year. Some people would call it a gap year. So young adults can come and be trained in all that methodology I've just been talking about. And they will be put into a team based in a local church. They'll stay with a Christian family and they'll reach into the community around them as part of a team. So they apply online. It's free. So basically it's all sponsored or subsidized, maybe is a better word. So it becomes free. All the costs are subsidized. So they only pay for their flight to get.
When you say free, my head's on tilt a bit. Free for a whole year?
Yeah. So accommodation is free. Their training is free. And their most of their meals are free. And they get trained. Yeah.
Okay, that sounds like a pretty good deal.
Yeah, it's a very good deal, isn't it? but they come to work, you know, they're coming, well, obviously, I don't mean an earner salary, but they're coming to work, they're coming to volunteer, they're coming to do, you know, graft, they're coming to graft, as we would say in England. So they're working, helping young people, reaching out to young people. They're not paid for it. And so it's free because it's subsidized because we partner with local churches. So some youth organizations will go to a city and say, give us money and we'll do the youth work for you. What we'll do is we'll go to a city and say, okay, church, we need to be reaching young people. Let us give you the resources to do that. And we'll work within the church to do that, to reach those different communities. So we give churches training, templates and teams in order to do that. So if you know somebody, or sorry, if one of your listeners knows somebody who's kind of 18 to 30 generally, then they would go on our website, which is PAIS Movement. So PAIS, paismovement.com. And there's a free mission year. Click on that. There's lots of questions that are answered, videos, more explanation. And they apply and they go through the application process. We're not looking for superstars necessarily. We're looking for people who already are very committed to the local church, who are serving, but they want to do more. They want to spend a year on an adventure, really, getting a mission experience, an experience of God, an experience mission. That's what we can do for them, yeah.
And so is that, you said it's through churches. Are they working in the church or in a business or in schools? Or
so
what are they doing?
Yeah, so most of our teams are working with youth, which means they're working in the schools. Right. And they're also working in youth programs. So they'll come, they'll be, like I say, they'll join a team. That team will be based in the church. They'll work alongside the pastor, the youth pastor, really helping the young people, ministering to the young people, doing whatever the youth pastor generally needs doing. But they come with an agenda. So their agenda is to make missionaries, if you like, of the young people. So they will teach and they will look for the young people that are most interested, and they will train them to reach the young people who are not interested. So that's Jesus' methodology, right? Yeah. Spread, spot, stay, send. So they're going to the youth group, spread, hey, I'm here to help you. If you lean towards God and you want to learn about discipleship, Bible study, evangelism, make a difference to the world, I want to disciple you in that. So they stay with those young people and then they send those young people out. So the other young people who wouldn't listen to an apprentice but might listen to their friend. But we also do have teams that work in with adults. So they would go into businesses. They might go into colleges and they would help the pastor with the general running of the church. But they're not interns. So interns are untrained, have no agenda. They just come and do whatever. We call them apprentices because they're being trained for a specific purpose, which is our language would be to make missionaries. Obviously, anything we do in school works within the frame of a school. In certain African nations, they're asking you to come in and preach the gospel. In other nations, they're saying you can't do that. You know, so we work with whatever the framework, the legal framework and the etiquette of the school is.
So they're basically multiplying themselves. That's
exactly.
Wow. Okay. And the basis for that, I think I read probably on your website, was that you noticed when you're at Sharon, or Sharon, however you pronounced it, was that there wasn't that many youth in your youth group, but there was hundreds, if not 1,000 youth in the schools.
Yeah, and it wasn't specifically Sharon Church, it was any church in North Manchester. You know, I think and we probably had a fairly healthy youth group, but it was still in the tens, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50, something like that.
Right.
Whereas there's hundreds, of course, yeah. And someone else is paid for the building with the school. Someone else is paying the staff. Someone else has done everything. I just had to turn up and do my thing. And at the end of it, schools would thank me. So I would go in most of the times in Britain because of the way that in England, kids have to be taught, students have to be taught six world faiths. One of them is Christianity. And there has been a law, I don't know if it's changed yet, but there was a law where if a school could not, they had to have an act of broadly Christian worship every day. And if a school teacher didn't want to do it, there was an onus on the school to find someone from outside. So it was an open door. So I'd come in and fulfill this mandate that they had to fulfill anyway. What I'd love to tell you, Sharon, is that the church in England absolutely thought, this is brilliant. We can, at virtually no cost, we can reach an entire generation. Let's get into the schools. Let's flood the schools. They need us. They want our help to share about Jesus. And that's just never happened. I mean, it happened in small bits, but we're so busy with our ministry that we forgot his mission.
Oh, wow. That's sad, very sad. I'm glad Incredible. That you're changing.
Now, what happens, and what will annoy me, is if that law changes, everybody will be up in arms about how the law's changed and how we've kicked out God from the schools. Well, right now, they're asking God to come into the schools, but the churches are not doing that. Yeah. Now, I'm not having to go at churches because I want to work with churches that do want to do that.
Yeah.
But it does annoy me that we would probably then complain about it. And we see in America, you know, schools are open in America. You don't have quite the same freedom as in England, but there are ways to legitimately, ethically work with a school where we can, at some point along the road, connect young people to Christianity or the message of Jesus. But we're just so caught up in our ministry. The recent survey came out, a George Banner survey came out, that this was in March of 2022, that the percentage of Christians who became Christian before the age of 18 or by the age of 18 is 94%.
Wow.
So 6% in North America, 6% of Christians became a Christian after 18.
Yeah. So if we want to be effective, we've really got to focus on.
Yeah. If we actually meant let's seek first the kingdom of God, then massive resources would be spent in that, and we would be helping schools in any way we could, just for the opportunity of serving them and the possibility of being able to connect young people to a church or to some kind of connected events or something. But we're just too wrapped up in our ministry. And, you know, I'm writing a book right now. In fact, I'm right now on the chapter. I'm looking at this contrast. How do we transition? How do we convert from Christian-centric to kingdom-centric? Right. And I look at 10 subjects, prayer, church, but just various different discipleship, all sorts of different ones. And the one I'm doing right now is serving. So what would our serving look like if we were more kingdom-centric than Christian-centric? And I would say Christian-centric, we prioritize our ministry. Kingdom-centric, we prioritize his mission. Right. And there are countless situations where our ministry is more important than his mission. And I think it's really sad. And I think that's what's stopping. One of the main things within Christian leadership that's stopping revival. I'm not waiting for God to do anything. I think he's done it.
Yeah.
What's stopping revival is us not being obedient, not being submitted, thinking we're following Jesus. And we are following Jesus, but we're doing it in a very Christian-centric manner. And I don't think Christian-centric Christianity will bring about revival, because it's basically about us. And anything about the kingdom is kind of like an optional upgrade if you're particularly that way inclined or
right.
on fire.
Well, I would love to ask you, we've only got a few minutes left, but you're a visionary and a pioneer and obviously doing things different to others. So I can't let a visionary go without asking, how do you see the future of your PAIS movement, what do you think is going to unfold as you go forward?
Okay, so simply put, the pandemic crippled our teams but catapulted our teaching. So our teams, you know, basically the pandemic was very hard for an organization that does, that brings people from across the seas to do schools ministry when nations called everybody home and shut down the schools and locked down the country. So from that perspective, we've had to restart and we're in the rebuilding process. But from a teaching perspective, that's really, so many churches are like, okay, we thought we were making disciples, but now we realize that maybe we weren't. And when the meeting left, when we couldn't do Sundays, we weren't effective. We didn't know what to do. So this idea of discipleship now is like, it's like I've always been the nerdy kid and now I'm the cool kid, because everybody's interested in discipleship now. So it was actually an Australian, a guy called Paul Bartlett, who once said, PAIS is a bit like the homeschool movement. You know, the homeschool movement is always seen as a little bit odd. But then because of the pandemic, everybody's like going to the homeschool and saying, how do you do this thing, you know?
Yeah.
And I think, you know, we were going on about discipleship for 20 years, 30 years actually, while everybody's been doing, let's put on great services and great programs. But now is, okay, that discipleship thing, how are you doing it? So for us, the future is spread, spot, stay, send, spreading beyond just people on PAIS, discovering who those are leaning forward, who are saying, okay, if to do God's mission, it's not about my program, it's about discipleship, what do I need to do? Yeah. And then staying with those people and then sending them out to reach the other churches that are not interested in talking to us but might be interested in talking to them.
We've run out of time. Can you quickly give us the website? Because I know people will want to work more deeply with you and get in contact. Can you give us that website address again?
Yeah, so it's www.paismovements, so paismovement.com. Wow. And you can click on, there's bits where churches can find out information, people want to do the gap year can find out information, and the resources page for our teaching and training and templates as well.
Thanks for being with us, Paul. I really appreciate you giving your time today.
No problem at all. Thanks so much.